gather here together to worship God and to offer our praise. Our church's mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And the way that we do that here is we love God, we love others, and we serve others. In your pews at the end, and maybe tucked somewhere in between, are the yellow connection cards. I invite each of you to please be sure to sign that this morning. Make sure that everybody has, you don't have to have your own separate card, but make sure everybody has their name written down. And on the back side of our is a place for your prayer concerns, a place if you would like to serve. You can include that there. And also this morning, if you're going to be able to come to the leadership summit this Saturday, it would be helpful for us to know so we can make sure we have enough handouts and snacks and that kind of thing. So please fill out the connection card and then I'll go straight into the leadership summit. It is our first annual leadership summit. All members of the congregation are invited to attend, particularly if you are leading a committee or on a committee. We're hoping that you'll come and be a part of that conversation. It starts at 8:30 this Saturday and will be done at about noon. So if you're planning on coming, it'll be helpful to let us know. And if you aren't sure yet, and you think, oh, I didn't write it down, I better not go, no, don't let that stop you, please come even if you don't let us know ahead of time. Please double check everything that's in the back of your worship folder. You'll get more details of things there. There are two things that are not on there. One is Carol Biter wants to make sure that you know about the lunch brunch meeting this Friday the 20th at noon at Granny's Restaurant. And you probably also saw as you walked in the door and posted in different places, this coming Thursday is game day on Fellowship Hall at 2 o'clock. Other things to be aware of, Pam asked for us to have anybody who has tickets to the Sweetheart Dinner to please hold up your hands. Okay, look around you, and then you will know who to go talk to after worship. Not during reading time, after worship. Go talk with them to get tickets for the Sweetheart Dinner. You can get more information about that on your worship folder and from them. There are sign-up sheets on the back table for the casserole ministry, for if you would like to participate doing a children's sermon, or if you would like to do altar flower sign-up. Grace and Peace Alliance has things listed of how you can participate by offering things for people who are in need in our community, and you can see the rest of it. Our church is involved in a variety of ministries and missions, and I think probably the baskets have already headed back. Have you seen them? Are they doing that? Are the baskets back there? Okay. This week it's for missions, so thank you for your support of the many things that our church does through missions. We've been in different places. We didn't have to deal with the road today, although there are some parts of our country that have some icy roads. But as we pray for them, we give thanks for the weather that we're having right now. And I pray that the Lord be with you. Let us worship together.
Isn't going to happen until we're willing to turn our backs on what the world worships. New life doesn't happen, doesn't occur because we are religious or act pious. New life becomes real when we abandon ourselves to the mystery of God. The prophet says it this way.
A song of praise to our God.
Many will see and fear, but their trust in the Lord. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the crowd, to those who go astray after false gods. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts towards us. None can compare with you. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be counted. Sacrifice and offering you do not desire, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin, an offering you have not required. Then I said, here I am. In the scroll of the book is written of me. I delight to do your will, O God. Your law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. See, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord. I have not hidden your saving help within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from the great congregation. Do not, O Lord, withhold your mercy from me. Let your steadfast love and your faithfulness keep me safe forever. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
God talks to us in different
different ways. God talks to us through other people, giving us comfort and saying, I'm so sorry you lost your cat. I'm so sorry you lost your dog. And, you know, that's really tough because I know I've got a dog and I've had cats and I've lost them too. And I know how bad that is. But, so people can comfort us. And there's something else that we're going to talk about today. And it's music and it's song. Because God can put a new song into our mouths. That means we can end up singing even after tough things happen because God can help us to deal with those things. And it's just a reminder that God's present. And I thought, and this is going to be an encouragement because I'm going to invite people to sing after a while. I'm going to say, just be sure to sing no matter how good your voice is. So I'm going to sing, and some of you already know, I can do an off-tune kind of thing pretty well. But I want, because I'm guessing you all know Jesus loves me, right? Yep, okay, I'm going to start it, but you're going to sing with me, and so are you, okay? I'm microphone, sing louder than me, okay? You ready?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
Children. But it's a pleasure and honor to having here for a short weekend. They flew in Friday and must, of necessity, fly home again tomorrow. But it's a great weekend.
What a wonderful gift. And Betty's here. Mr. Betty's here from Massachusetts too, but we'll trust that she's here. She's local. We're glad that you're here this morning. And now let's bow our heads in prayer. Holy God, we come into your presence with singing, rejoicing in your love for us, for the way you've cared for your people throughout time, and for the way you continue to care for us today. We're grateful for the peace and the comfort that gives us, for the courage that gives us to live each day, even knowing that life includes challenges that sometimes overwhelm us. But remind us that you are with us, God. Help us to see your light, to feel your love, and to share that light and love so that those who don't know might come to know it. We lift up to you the needs of our community, our church, and our world. We pray for those who are dealing with sickness, with challenges at home, at work, or at school. We pray for Stacy as she prepares for surgery, and we give you thanks for the healing that you offer. We pray for Dan and for his family and for all of those who grieve, giving our trust in your hope for the resurrection. We pray for those who are hungry, who are alone, who don't have a place to lay their head. We pray for our state and for our nation, particularly for our leaders, as we experience transition. We pray for those who are worried about their health care and ask for wisdom as those decisions are being made. We thank you for family, God. We thank you for loved ones who surround us, who show us their care, who remind us of the love that you have for each and every one of us. We trust you, God. We place our hope in you, and we ask you now to please hear our silent prayers. All of these things we pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
you bow your heads for me in prayer? Thank you, God, for your love, for your grace, for your power, for the miracles that you offer in everyday kinds of ways. You've blessed us, God. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our shield. Amen. We are on the second Sunday after Epiphany, the time in the church where we remember the Magi, the three wise men, as they came bringing gifts to the Christ child following the light of the star. This is a season of light, of God's light. Although sometimes we don't see it, sometimes we can't feel it, sometimes we just can't seem to experience it. And yet, the verse of this season is from John, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not and will not overcome it. I remember one of the first times that I flew in an airplane. I was flying out of Fort Wayne, and it was winter time, and it was cold, and it was dreary, and it may have been rainy. There may have been a little bit of snow on the ground, but that disappears quick with rain. And it was just bleh. And I got into the airplane, and we went up, and we did that bumpy thing through the clouds, and then we emerged on the other side. And I'd never experienced that before. I don't know if it's because I'd flown the summertime before or what, but oh my gosh, there was sunshine, it was bright, it was beautiful, and it was January, and it was amazing. And ever since then, in January, times like this, I look up and I go, "Sun, I know you're there. I know you're up there, so don't try hiding." Okay, so you are. Makes no difference. You're there. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. I may not see it, I may not feel it, I may not be experiencing it today, but that light continues to shine. The psalmist in Psalm 20 was having a no good, very bad, terrible, horrible time. We don't know what that was, but he described it as being in a time when he was in a desolate pit, when he was in a miry bog, and he cried out to the Lord, and he patiently waited on the Lord. And it doesn't exactly say it, but the patiently waited for the Lord makes me think that he waited for some time. He was crying out to the Lord for some time, and waiting, and waiting. And the Lord heard his cry and inclined his ear. God heard his cry and drew him out of the desolate pit, out of that miry bog, and set his feet upon a rock, upon a firm place, on a solid place, a place where he could take a breath, where things were okay. Maybe things were even good. And that caused him to have a song. God put a song in his mouth, a song of praise to God, a song of thanksgiving, a song of deliverance. Thank you, God, for putting my feet back onto solid ground. In the 7 months that we have been together, I have heard some of your stories, and you have heard some of mine. And I know that many of us have experienced times in the course of our lives where you felt as though you have been in a desolate pit, in a miry bog, stuck in the mud. And maybe you're still in one of those places today. You are crying out to the Lord. You are being as patient as possible. Lord, hear my cry. Attune to my ear. And the really good news that we're reminded of in this psalm, and that we can see through the evidence of Scripture and from the witnesses of individuals throughout Scripture is that God does indeed hear our cries. God does respond. Maybe not immediately. Maybe we need to be patient. Maybe we continue to cry out, but God hears our cry and responds to our need. I think about the different times in the Bible. I think of when the people of Israel cried out to God while they were enslaved in Egypt, and God responded and released them from slavery. Later, God released them from exile in Babylon. Later, God delivered the people, including us, God delivered people throughout all time through the giving of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We read then in Paul, through Paul's words, about the various experiences that he had along the way, how God continued to deliver him and how he would respond with songs of joy and thanksgiving for what God has done, sharing with others so that others could see and could come to know too. We respond in thanksgiving. It puts a song in our hearts when God hears our cry and responds to our pleas. Thanks be to God. And so as that song comes into our hearts, I think of what a healing thing music is. About how singing, how music, how listening. Sometimes when there are no words that I can express the emotions, the experience that I'm experiencing, the thing that I'm living through, whether it be challenges or just incredible beauty and joy, it's hard to put those in words. And so sometimes music expresses those things in incredible ways. Music can bring healing. Music can be salve to the soul. The name of today's message comes from the 17th century poet and playwright William Congreve, who seems to me, as I looked at his, I hadn't heard of William Congreve. If you are really into literature and the arts, you say, oh, Toni, that just shows what you don't know. But he seems to have been misquoted quite often. We know his quotes really better than, or his misquotes better than his quotes. And the poor guy, he's been misinterpreted as being, things he's written has been misinterpreted as being written by William Shakespeare. So, you know, I guess if you're going to be misconstrued for somebody, it's like, well, he's a good guy. So one of the things that he wrote that you may be familiar with, Love for Love from 1695, not necessarily that play, but O5-ness, you must not kiss and tell. The O5-ness, you probably don't use that language very often, but you've heard that you must not kiss and tell. Something else that he said that I didn't put in a slide is don't go to bed angry. Stay up and fight all night. That was the end of that. 2 years later, he wrote in Mourning Bride, heaven has no rage like love to hatred turn, nor hell a fury like a woman scorn. And also in that same play, he wrote, music has charms to serve to soothe a savage breast. And it goes on to say, to soften rocks or bend a knotted oak. And the way we have misquoted that is music has charms to soothe a savage beast. And when I think of this, I think of Saul. I think of King Saul, 1 Samuel chapter 16. It talks about how the Spirit of God left Saul and a spirit of evil entered him. And he would have these episodes of rage. He would just get so angry and he would scare everybody. And he was a really good guy. But then he would have one of these episodes. And so his servant said to him, let's find someone. Would you mind if we would like go out, put an ad in the paper, and interview some guys, and maybe see if somebody can come in and play the lyre for you, and see if that settles you. And that's when David came into the scene, and David would play for King Saul, and it would settle him. It would calm him down. It was a good thing. And he grew to love David. And then his jealousies took over and things got bad after that, but we're staying with this part of the story. Music soothed the savage beast. Music heals. Music brings comfort. Music soothes. I've been hearing for years about the effects of music on us. Each one of us, as our mothers carried us in her womb, we could hear music, apparently. And if your mom was one who was a rocker, it probably got us going. Fetal movement increases with something like that. But if your mom was into quiet classical music, then that probably slowed things down and soothed things. Soothed you when you were in your mother's womb. The different kinds of music that we listen to serves to help form different parts of our brain. Music stimulates the sections of the brain involved in physical movement, attention, planning, and memory. Listening to music can help relieve chronic pain by up to 21% and depression by up to 25%. The American Society of Hypertension says that listening to music just 30 minutes a day can significantly reduce your blood pressure. If you're hypotensive, listen to rock music. But if it's high, listen to some other stuff. Listening to instrumental music can improve cognitive performance. Music can elevate hormone levels. You're saying, what's that picture about? I Googled hormone levels. This is the best one. It was there. I don't know why. I didn't ask. I said, yep, the dog, he's cute. Music can elevate hormone levels. Music can help our physical endurance. Research shows that cyclists listening to music use 7% less oxygen than those who don't listen to music. Listening to music is associated with the body's ability to fight off disease. Music does a lot of really good things, doesn't it? Dr. Daniel Levitin of McGill, a psychologist who studies the neuroscience of music, tells us what we already know. Music unites us. And so we come together in worship. We come from our separate places. And you know, the announcements and the call to worship, we're starting to bind together at that point. And then we start singing a hymn together. And we join together in a chorus. Even if you're not one who sings, you're probably focused on the words, and it unites us. When we've gone to baseball games, the crowd is there, all kinds of things are happening, people are watching different things, some of us are crowd watching, some of us are watching the game, and then we sing, take me out to the ball game, and everybody's there together, and it's so good, and it's so much fun, we're united, and then it stops, and we go back to all our different stuff. I have a friend that told me, I don't know, but I was told that in Britain, they sing, oh no, I forgot. You'll never walk alone. Before a soccer game, before it starts, they passionately sing, you'll never walk alone. That's an American song that somehow ended up in Britain. And before the soccer games, they sing it, hurrah! And then they're all united. And then they all bust out into competition again. Music unites us. It helps to form us into a community. It heals us. It brings us together. God drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. As I was working on my message, I kept on thinking about the African-American spirituals, about the songs that the slaves sang in early America. And there were different reasons why they sang, but they brought together their rhythms and their language and their dance. They remembered their homeland. And a whole lot of those are spirituals that called out to God to bring them healing, to help move them beyond the place where they were that day and help them think of a new day when God would save them, would redeem them. I was looking in our hymnal, just a quick look, and I found several. Swing low, sweet chariot, go down Moses, feel away to Jesus. I know there are more in our United Methodist hymnals. There's another one. This one was written in 1921, so well after slavery, but still before we got into the civil rights movement, so an important time. James Weldon Johnson and J. Rosamond Johnson, who were brothers, wrote, "Lift Every Voice and Sing." And it's a powerful hymn. And if I would have thought about it as we were doing our planning, we'd be singing that today, but I didn't get to say, do we know that song? And we'll be singing it. We'll be singing along. But it evokes powerful images of home, the unity, and the strength that God gives us. Music can lift us up. Music brings healing. There's a story that I want to share with you. On a cold and snowy November evening, a man says, I arrived at a senior facility where I agreed to provide some after-dinner entertainment. Now, I've never liked going out in the cold, and this particular night was no exception. I was frozen to the bone. As soon as I was greeted at the door by a jolly, warm-hearted woman, I stepped inside and immediately forgot all about being cold. The stage was all set up for me, and the caregivers had obviously worked hard on decorations. The auditorium was filled to the brim with seniors in wheelchairs, with walkers, crutches, and all seemed to have looks of despair. I knew where those looks came from. Many were in pain, both physically and mentally. Most were lonely, spawned by the daily routine and absence of family members. Some were entirely forgotten about, like an old pair of shoes no longer needed. I felt their pain. About 15 minutes into my show, I decided to have a sing-along. I chose the song, You Are My Sunshine. I wanted music everyone knew and a happy, upbeat song. During the singing, I walked from the stage into the audience and with a huge smile, began clapping my hands to the rhythm and to the beat of the song. One by one, each person in the audience began clapping along, including a man in a wheelchair sitting near the stage with his caregiver close beside. As the aging man began to clap, the caregiver was astonished. Sensing that this was unusual, I bent down to meet his eyes and sang just to him. He began to join me in singing, clapping the entire time. After my gig was over, I stopped by the office to pick up my check. As I entered the room, I was surprised to see it so full of administrators and nurses. The applause gave me chills, but I couldn't figure out why this was happening. I didn't have to wonder long. It seems that the gentleman in the wheelchair had experienced a miraculous event. Up until my show, he was unable to speak or feed himself. Even therapy was uneventful for him. But something happened during the sing-along, and for the first time since his stroke, he was able to coordinate his hands and even sing. Singing also had brought back his speaking voice. Music heals. It connects. It restores. It helps us to deal with the spiritual affective disorder. that we each experience at some point in our lives. Music can help us to communicate in a way that some of us have trouble communicating. It can help us to go to a deeper place and to listen for God's voice. So I invite you to think of some practical times, some practical ways. When you're working in the kitchen, when you're working around in the house, when you guys are doing whatever you do in the garage, have some music on in the background. Maybe you'll be singing to it as you're doing your stuff. But you know, even if you're not, background music, I think our bodies, our spirits still receive it and experience it. Listen to whatever music, whatever kind of music makes your heart soar. And when you come into this place, don't be afraid to sing. I can't sing. I get off tune sometimes. But God loves our voices. God loves to hear us sing. And when we come together, let it be a safe place where those who can stay on tune can sing louder. And the rest of us can blend in, that we might lift our voices in praise and thanksgiving. Because music is this incredible gift that we've been given. So may we receive the song that God has given us, and may we lift it up in joy and thanksgiving. Amen.
Our God has done wondrous things, too numerous to count. Through steadfast love and faithful care, God enriches us in every way. Therefore, do not delay. Let us offer to God ourselves this day, all that we have and all that we are, in praise and love of Christ. The ushers will now come forward.
Thank you.
sing "Here I Am, Lord," number 593.
Song in your heart and on your lips, in Jesus' name, amen.